Hi, this is Graham from Jennings Astro. This is a video about taking astrophotographs while you're away on summer holidays. Now, as you might be able to see, I've travelled away from my usual location of the UK. I've come on summer holiday to Greece. And before we left home, I started to think, what could I do in terms of taking some astrophotographs while I was away? Specifically, because we've travelled quite a long way south, I wanted to see if I could capture some parts of the sky that I normally can't see easily from the UK. Specifically, the southern part of the sky towards Sagittarius. So I didn't want to bring a whole load of astro kit, so tracking mount, heavy tripod. So what I decided to do is to just bring my camera with a couple of lenses. I've got a wide angle lens, 14mm lens and the standard lens. And a very simple flexible tripod and a usual shutter release that I use so I can take timed exposures. And the idea is to take a series of very short exposures, each one of which should be short enough to not result in any star trails. And then when I get home is to stack all those together and see if I can produce a decent image of those regions of the sky I can't normally see. So, how long can you expose the image for before you start to see star trails? I'm pretty intolerant of star trails personally. Even if I'm taking a wide field view, as you might get from a lens like this, then I still tend to zoom in and zoom in until I can look at each individual star, and I don't like to see trailing. So, in order to avoid that, there's a fairly well established rule called the 1 in 500 rule. Now, this rule states that if you take 500 and divide it by the focal length of your lens, and that tells you the number of seconds for which you can expose the frame before you see star trails. So, for example, if you have a standard lens, a 50mm lens, you have 500 divided by 50 is 10 seconds. And if you have a wide angle lens, this is 14mm, then you do 500 divided by 14 and you get 36 seconds. Now they sound like reasonably decent exposure times, especially for a wide angle lens. And given that a modern camera has, you can put the ISO up to a high value, definitely sounds like it's worth giving it a go. One word of caution though, those figures, they don't really tell the whole story. They work pretty well for a full frame camera, but most of us are using cameras with cropped sensors. So for example, this one, Canon 700D, I need to apply another factor of about 1.5 in order to get the right exposure, or the maximum exposure. So going back to our standard lens, we have 500 divided by the 50mm lens, then we need to divide by another 1.5, and it takes the 10 seconds down to around 7. Now for the wide angle lens, we have the 500mm, 500 divided by 14, divided by 1.5, and we have around 23 seconds. So in theory, 23 seconds with one of these, pretty decent. Okay, so I've taken my first few frames last night of the Sagittarius region. I've started with the wide angle lens, and definitely worth pursuing this. I can see nebulosity, clouds of gas and dust that I've never been able to see at all from the UK. Second thing I noted is that the 21 second value which I chose, I took a little bit off the theoretical maximum value. I was exposing at 21 seconds, and if I zoom in and zoom in and zoom in and zoom in, I can see star trails. And I guess that reflects the fact that I'm looking at an object that is right the way down near the celestial equator. Hence, in a given period of time, the object is moving a little bit more than is allowed for by the rule of thumb rules that I've explained. So what I'm going to do is repeat some of those exposures, and this time I'm going to take the exposure down to 18 seconds, and we'll see if that resolves the problem and we can get a good stack of images of Sagittarius. So, heading home soon, got quite a few shots stored away in the camera over a few nights. Mainly I've focused on those southern areas of the sky that I can't see from home, but I've also taken some shots, wide field shots, looking towards the summer triangle area, Cygnus, to see how they compare to the sort of shots I've taken at home. Probably maybe they're quite similar, I expect. And also I've looked at the pole area, which is quite different from home, the relative orientation of Polaris and Ursa Major in the sky. So hopefully we can get some good results. Things to note, if you're planning to do a session like this, I suppose the trick is to follow the usual rules to make sure that you've got the image frame composed well before you take 100 shots on an automated shutter release. So that's the first thing. The second thing, I guess, is the focus, as always critical, but I'd say know the focus of your lenses before you head out. Particularly, you can't rely on the infinity position by rolling the focus all the way around. On this wide angle lens, the Samyang 14mm f2.8, I know from experience that there's a figure marked at 3 feet on the focusing ring, and that's actually where the lens reaches infinity focus, which is about a rotation of 45 degrees from the end stop. And similarly on the 50mm lens I've been using, you've got it's quite a precise focus on that one. It's definitely worth trying to make a mark on the edge of the lens, on the edge of the plastic on the focusing ring, so you know in advance where it's going to be achieving a good focus. Other than that, nothing really to know, just play around with the ISO. I've done that, try some fast exposures up at 6400 ASA, but normally, certainly here in Greece, I've found that the ambient light conditions are such that probably 1600 ASA is a good speed, and most of the frames I've captured have been at that setting. So I'm going to go home and see if it's been worthwhile. So having spent some time at home with Deep Sky Stacker, I've produced a few outputs. You can see here, I think that the principle works pretty well. You can take short exposures, stack them together, and you don't need to take your tracking mount. Probably, I think the lesson learned for me would be to take more frames. But when I was trying to experiment with this, I suppose at the time I had to choose between multiple targets, multiple film speeds, and a couple of lenses. So I think I'd probably try and settle on fewer combinations and then achieve a better overall picture by grabbing more frames. But overall, I think the experiment's worked. It's definitely worth taking a camera and a basic tripod on holiday if you've got room, and giving it a go, looking at some new regions of the sky. Okay, thanks for watching.